The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the community of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Happy St. Patrick's Day to you too, Chris. Hannah, would you like to come and light our Christ candle for us this morning? It is in the light of this candle, in the light of Christ, that we follow and find our way to peace. Peace within, peace beyond. Thank you. Hannah.
Please join me in the reading of our land acknowledgement. We begin this gathering by acknowledging the land on which we in the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, and Lenape peoples, many of whom continue to live and work today. This territory is covered by the Upper Canada Treaties, particularly Treaty Number 6, and is within the land protected by the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Agreement. Today is a gathered place at home to many First Nations, Métis, Inuit people, and acknowledging this reminds us that our great standard of living is directly related to the resources and friendship of the Indigenous people. Top of the morning to you. My name is Cheryl Partington, and I'd like to welcome everyone to our service, whether you're here in the room with us today or you're at home watching online. Please join us for Holy Week services beginning next Sunday with Palm Sunday. When you're asked to bring a small branch from a tree to wave, we're going to have a procession. Christina did not order branches from the other side of the world for us to wave, which shows her excellent stewardship principles. Good Friday will be a joint service at 9:44 and will be a worship of scripture and readings. Christina needs some help. She needs 5 people to participate. If you're willing and able to do this, please talk to her after worship today, or you can email her during the week. Easter morning will begin in MacKillop Park at 7:30, followed by a breakfast. I understand Peter Case is going to personally cook for us. And our Easter service here in the sanctuary will be at 9:44, and we will enjoy communion. I have one announcement. This is the last Sunday you can get your Marie Bottrell tickets here at church. Please see me after worship, and I'll be glad to provide you with your tickets. If you can't today, then see Jan in the office during the week. Thank you. Now, please join me in the call to worship. Your proportions are in the bold type. Okay. Lent is a time to journey from where we have been to a new life and to remember that life is a cycle. Just as every journey has its beginning, we remember that every moment is a beginning. Life is a cycle. Unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. Come, let us worship the God of resurrection, for life is a cycle from birth to death and beyond. The one constant is in life. Thanks be to God. Now please join us in the singing of our opening hymn, Three Things I Promise, which is from Voices, More Voices, number 176. And if you can stand as you're able, please. Thank you. Let us pray. Write your love on our hearts, God of all. Place your call into the deepest depths of our soul.
Because you are our people, always.
Because you are our God,
always.
Let your spirit move us, change us, drop us in the earth, and then make us grow in Jesus' name. Amen.
Today we're going to learn what I would call liturgical movement, what you guys can just call actions, okay? We're gonna sing a song together and we're gonna learn the actions, okay? Okay? Great, okay. Are you with me? Good, let's begin. Try them with me. We sing things like, hey, Spirit, come here. Spirit of life, come unto me. We don't need to. That's really us talking to ourselves, because Spirit of life is always with us, because it's deep down inside of you, because you're moving, you have actions, right? But it's good for us to remember that the Spirit is with us. So on your way, and wait for everybody, Torsten. There you are. There you are. Off you go. Just wait for everybody. Try and keep an eye out for the Spirit while you're down there.
Our scripture passage this morning is taken from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 20 to 23. And we have wonderful Sharan McDonald here to read for us. Thank you.
I don't remember the last time I was called wonderful. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was born and who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew, and then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from the heaven, "I have glorified it, and it will glorify again." The crowd standing there heard it and said it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out, and I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. May the Spirit bless us with wisdom and wonder as we ponder the meaning of these words for our lives.
Please rise as you're able Please rise as you are able in body and in spirit to sing "The Tree of Life and the Awesome Mystery." It's from Voices United, number 121.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God, hold us close, we pray, as we wrestle together Jesus' words to us this day. And may the words of my mouth be acceptable in your sight. And may all the meditations of our hearts bear fruit like a grain of wheat. Amen. During the Lenten conversations this week, which happen around 12:30 on Wednesday afternoon, and we've got a couple more coming if you would like to join us, we thought about which story of Jesus stands out for us. And as I recollect, most of the stories were of things Jesus had done. He fed the 5,000. He encountered the woman at the well. We discussed high Christologies and low Christologies. The guy's storytelling was extraordinary. I mean, he could capture one's imagination, and at the end of whatever story he was telling, he'd have us pondering, and deeply. And at the end, he would make visible some truth or some pearl of wisdom. Sometimes he speaks in reversals. Often it sounds like more of a conundrum than anything. But it again, begs our minds to ponder, because his stories were not to entertain. Sometimes Jesus would get a little ticked, as I've mentioned before, wishing that, you know, they or we would catch on a little bit faster. And this might be one of those times. Here we are on the edge of Holy Week, the edge of when it is that the whole Christian story culminates. He's been in ministry for 3 years with these people, and still they need explaining. Verse 33, he said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The disciples by now should not have needed that explanation of verse 33. They know the context within which Jesus was doing his ministry. They know the things that he has been saying has been challenging the temple authorities. They know that he's on a mission of social justice. The disciples shouldn't have needed an explanation at that stage of the game. Nor should we. We should know well by now that life in this world is just not the life God intends for us. And that this world is far too oppressive and full of injustice. This world is riddled with oppression. It doesn't get much worse than the elimination of political opponents in Russia, where they're on their now third and final day of voting. Oppression is crossing borders with social media as the US votes to ban the TikTok app, because apparently they think that it might pose a threat to voter. It would pose a threat of voter interference. Election disruption is a grave concern in our country as well. I think there's a, what's it called? It's a election security and election integrity and security. Security and integrity. Anyway, there's a whole department now. This week, the war in Syria marks its 14th anniversary. And that civil war started by peaceful protests that were objecting to the oppression of the regime in that country. This world is far too violent. Zelensky claimed just a couple of weeks ago that 31,000 Ukrainian troops have been killed. and that's in defense of their own country. Interestingly enough, it's the same number of people that have been killed in the Hamas-Israel war. And I don't even like to call it a war. It's not a war. Anyway, just like in Ukraine, it's not a war. It's not a war. People are just defending what is theirs. But over 30,000 of those people are Palestinian and about 1,400 Israeli. 94 journalists, okay, again, of that 94, 89 are Palestinian, and over 136 UN aid providers, okay? This world has far too much violence, has far too much sexism. When rape continues to be a strategic tool in war for the sole purpose of driving men insane, thinking that they are raising the child of an enemy, forcing women into single parenthood in war-torn contexts. That's not to mention, I think there's something like 50,000 women in Gaza are pregnant right now. Some have had to undergo C-sections without anesthetic. Starvation is rampant in Gaza, Sudan, Haiti, Yemen, which is just a different kind of violence. A bit closer to home, even too close to home, your General Secretary, Michael Blair, announced a couple of weeks ago at the executive that only 45% of the communities of faith in our denomination have submitted their remit decisions, which has a deadline of March 31st, which means that the remit is going to fail because a non-vote is a vote no. I don't even know what that's going to do with our relationship with indigenous peoples in this country. I don't know. I could go on, but I won't. All that, to put it crudely, is sad. And we lament. We hold them in prayer. We cry out on social media, and it's sincere. We sincerely, from the bottom of our hearts, lament and object to the injustice of it all. But that won't affect the system of this world. That will not have anywhere near the sufficient effect against this world's violent and oppressive culture. And we know it. We know that. And here's how I know that we know. Because whenever we read about these things, no one's surprised. I mean, we lament. But you do not hear anyone saying, wow, that came out of left field, didn't expect that. Or are you kidding? Like another mass shooting? That's totally random. Or said no one ever, the Christian church treating the indigenous with disrespect? Got me. So surprised. Said no one ever. No one is saying that. We have normalized this oppression and other forms of violence to the point of knowing it's going to happen. We know this goes on, and yet very, very little is done to reverse it. We love to respond to the symptoms of this violence, but seldom the cause. We're so happy, you know, when we hear that food aid arrives, right? But we're far too slow in dealing with the causes of hunger and impoverishment, because that'll probably affect the stock market. We have to ask ourselves, who's benefiting from this? Who's benefiting from this violence? Who's gaining from the sale of tanks and arms? Buckle up. A tiny fraction of the answer to that question is us. We're benefiting because we live in the province of Ontario. For the economy of the province, because there's some great big huge company, what's it called? Rochelle. They're right now waiting for Ottawa to approve another shipment of armored tanks to Israel. And, you know, Ottawa's like, oh, I don't know, do we do it? Let's wait until there's something else so that everybody will start paying attention to that, and then we can just... And how much did Manitoba make in the constant shipment of arms to Saudi Arabia? And still does. We know all this goes on, and yet so very, very little is done to reverse it. We love to respond to the symptoms. And I think that it's true, because in this world, we applaud those who deal with the symptoms. Oh, you volunteer with the youth down at the center. Good for you. I mean, they're such a headache at that age, aren't they? Good for you. Oh, you donate to the food bank? Good for you. Good for you. Oh, you gave that $5 billion to the hospital the other day to buy that machine? Good for you. You give by par to Riverside? Oh, we love when you give by par. Good for you. And I'm not joking, I'm being 100% sincere when speaking about your contributions about time and talent to Riverside. The church, and believe me, it matters to me if you give to the church, because I'm like a big expense to you. So I do. I applaud your giving. Because if you didn't give, like if all the people in all the churches didn't ever give, there wouldn't be a church, right? So sincerely, I applaud you. In fact, I sent you all a letter this week asking you to make a special giving because it's Easter or something, you know? And we should be giving to our church, and we should be giving food to the food bank, and we should be giving our millions to organizations that help others who are oppressed and experience violence in this world. And even though I don't have billions, and I never will, I know that the few thousand that I give matters, as does yours. It really, really matters. Because Jesus did feed 5,000. He did. And he did sit with the ones who were marginalized, to the woman who had to go in the middle of the day to the well because everybody hated her so much. That's where he found this woman. So yeah, we do need to applaud that. 100% sincere, but That's not what I heard Jesus say today. Not today. Yes, he told us that the poor will be with us always, but that doesn't mean that we can be complicit in a system that makes that true, that ensures that there indeed will be always the poor, that ensures there will always be the marginalized, always be the oppressed by gender, sexual orientation, socioeconomic location, race, or creed. Today, Jesus is saying it is the system we need to be directing our efforts towards. It is the system we need to be unpacking and examining and thinking about, because if we did that, we might reach a point one day when it would be a huge surprise that political opponents are murdered and our federal government doesn't have to have an election integrity and security department. That would surprise us. Right now it doesn't, because we just know, oh yeah, that's the world. When Jesus is talking about this world, he is pointing out that it is contrary to God's world, contrary to the kingdom of God. Jesus is talking about the systems that make the world go round. And you know what makes the world go round? Joel Gray, do you remember that song in Cabaret, right, Joel Gray? Because we all know money makes the world go round right now. Jesus suggested to them then and to us now that living in this world within this system is a lost life. And here we hear Jesus telling us in those confounding reversals of his, verse 25, those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. So here we are on the edge of Holy Week, on the edge of when the whole of the Christian story culminates, and it culminates in a horrifically violent act, a crucifixion. It culminates in violence because that is part of the system we uphold. Might is stronger than right. The one with the most bombs wins. Empires are empires by merit of how much violence they can threaten others with. And anyone who disrupts that system isn't applauded. They're imprisoned. They're labeled disruptors. They're labeled disruptors. And it's kind of a term that they're embracing, actually, but not a term that came to mind for many of us in the Lenten study, though one did, when they thought about the story of Jesus that mattered to them, they remembered the turning over of the tables, right? But often we prefer the caring side, the healer, the storyteller. And too often we disregard the disruptor. And I'm here to tell you that I believe they probably wouldn't have killed Jesus for healing too much, for caring too much, for telling too many stories, right? He was disruptive. And there's lots of agencies that do that work that is commonly applauded, right, dealing with the symptoms. And as disciples of Jesus, yes, that is part of our work, to be sure. To be sure, that is part of our work. But unequivocally, it is not all of our work. Jesus calls us to be disruptors. Jesus calls us to live our lives with the vision of reaching for the world God intends for us. And we can't do that when we're busy applauding each other for the band-aids. The system we live in as a church, actually impedes us from being disruptors. And I think I've mentioned this before, but the CRA, they've audited us. By us, I mean the denomination, because legally we're only allowed to dedicate 10% of our resources to the work of disruption. That's the work of seeking justice. We can do, like, with all our money, we can spend towards charity. Oh, they love it when we do our charitable work, because it keeps them from having to do it, right? We're doing all the charity work, and but if you spend more than 10%, you're at risk of losing your charitable donation number, right? Which scares us, because then we don't know whether you'd still give or not. Friends, in the face of violence, often, we can find ourselves feeling like there's nothing that we can do. Especially if you hear about this violence that's happening on the other side of the ocean. You know, we're cushy here in our little turtle island, right? What can we do? Nothing we can do. But there is one thing. And that one thing is so simple, and yet so much more disruptive than you can imagine. We love. We love with all that we have and with all that we are. We love friend and we love foe. We love the stranger, the imprisoned, the bad guys. We love the imprisoned. We love the lost, the disenfranchised. We love creation. And that's hard to do, because I'm not talking about forests and rainbows. I'm talking about pipelines and respecting waterways. We love foe, and I'm not talking about, like, it serves us no purpose to spew out hate towards the pathological world leaders. We must love them. And we must encourage the leaders that we know have their sight on all that is just. I'm going to invite you into disruption, because disruptive love is what is necessary. Disruptive love that loves no matter the creed or race or socioeconomic location. And I know that sounds really anticlimactic. Oh, you know, minister said we should love. I know that sounds anticlimactic. But by the power of that love, that we can be the disruptors God calls us to be. And most importantly, and possibly the hardest thing that God asks of us, and in fact requires of us, so that we are able to leave this world, this system, this violence, this oppression, is to love ourselves. And truly, or so Jesus says, by that love, the rulers of this world will be driven out. This is the good news, my friends. May it be so. Amen. Peter probably better than anyone would tell you that it was Pi Day this week. And that was on the 14th. I don't know what day of the week that was, Thursday. And the United Church of Canada honors Pi Day in their own way, because, you know, that's what the United Church does. And Pi stands for public, intentional, and explicit. It is a way of being affirming and being inclusive of all. I don't know, maybe loving disruptively. So Wayne has found, on behalf of M68, a minute for mission for us this morning.
Rainbow Camp would be to safe space for the kids, to educate them, and to make them feel a part of something.
You know, these are our young people who've gone through hell and back 51 weeks out of the year.
Because so many of our kids are coming to us from broken homes, are lonely, are isolated, whether in the city or rural areas. These kids are feeling alone, and the one thing that we can give them, even if it's only for 5 days, is a sense of community.
It makes me wish that I was still young enough to be here in 2012 when the camp opened.
If you're under the LGBTQ2+ umbrella, then you're gonna meet people that you can relate to and talk to and support you. And if even if you're not, you're gonna meet people that are gonna have so many stories to help you come out as a more educated and just more well-rounded person.
The more society grows, hopefully, the less we will need Rainbow Camp.
You're coming out with support group no matter who you are.
It's incredible. It's giving LGBTQ2+ kids an opportunity to experience camp and to feel safe and to feel comfortable and to enjoy one of those things that many kids get to enjoy without being worried about judgment or being mistreated or bullied because of who they are.
Disruptive offering. If you're watching from home, you can use an e-transfer now, or you can call the office and Jan will take care of you. Because of your givings, we can offer a home to youth Monday through Thursday night every week. They're here having fun and having positive influences, and that's because of your offerings. So now let's pass the plate. Thank you.
Reprieve. But friends, now we're going to pray for the world. Let us pray. Oh God, we pray for the world this day. We know that praying for the world means, first of all, being aware of what's happening around the world. It means sharing in your loving compassion for all and praying, no matter whether the news is full of great joy or devastating sorrow, boringly ordinary, startling, unexpected, or worse, expected and horrific. Praying for the world means stretching ourselves to pray with love, even for those we hate, and it means being honest enough to admit that sometimes we want to call you to account in the face of great evil or disaster. So today we pray with the words of Saint Francis, who wrote these words so very long ago. And they were prayed on so many hearts and so many lips, from places of longing and of agony, and from places of peace seeking more peace. O God, make us instruments of your peace. In all countries with armed conflict, Palestine and Israel, Ukraine and Russia, many countries in Africa, India, Afghanistan, Myanmar, Pakistan, Philippines, Mexico, and Colombia. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. In India, where Parliament is voting on a citizenship law that excludes Muslims. Where there is injury, O God, give us pardon. For the visible and invisible injuries of trauma, for still captured and just freed Israeli hostages. For the starving people of Gaza awaiting aid. Where there is doubt, faith. For the hopeful, as Japan courts say a same-sex marriage ban is illegal. Where there is despair, hope. For the hundreds of young tech victims rescued from the Philippines Love Scam Center, where they were forced into running illegal operations online. Where there is darkness, light. For the grieving in Australia's gold mine collapse. For the people of Haiti as gang violence sweeps through the capital city. Where there is sadness, joy. For people like Ibrahim Abu Hani, a baker and co-owner of Bartul Cakes, a family business in Rafah in the Gaza Strip that is making cakes for people living in tents. And we pray for the owners of the Rochelle Company who are profiting from the sale of arms that they may be moved towards peace. For the many worldwide, daily, creatively working for peace, love, pardon, faith, hope, and joy, we thank you, God, for how you work in and through us. Hear now, O God, our personal prayers that we share with you in the silence of our hearts. O Divine One, grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love, For it is in the giving that we receive, it is in the pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying like a grain of wheat that we are born to eternal life. This we pray, saying the words of our disruptor Christ, Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, and the glory. Friends, let us rise and sing our closing hymn, When We Are Living. To invite you into a couple of possible acts of disruptive love this week. And it may be disruptive to you as well as the rest of the world, but I'm going to invite you to disrupt your day, to make your voice heard to your MP, to vote in favor of Canada calling for a ceasefire in the Middle East. And or, I invite you to call your General Secretary of the United Church of Canada, Michael Blair, and beg him to extend the deadline of the remit submissions so that the non-votes aren't counted as no votes. I invite you to leave this time to be disruptive lovers of the world, for the world desperately needs disruptive lovers. Sing with me, please.
Spirit of life, come unto me. Sing in our hearts all the stirrings of compassion.
desk thing and go to your postlude, please. Please be seated.